And welcome to Safari Live. Beautiful impala feeding off to the side. My name is Byron, and with me on camera this morning I have Viam. Morning, Viam. And my colleague James and David on the other vehicle this morning. We have Lou and Chelsea in the FC, in the final control, the voices in my head. So they'll be speaking to us all morning. Again, a great welcome to you to Safari Live. Still quite cool. You can see I've got the gloves and the beanie and the scarf. We are situated in the Greater Kruger National Park, right up in the northeastern part of South Africa. We are on a game reserve called Juma, and it is great to have you all with us. Don't forget, we are live, so please send us your questions via Twitter on TV. We've got this beautiful herd of impala feeding off to the side just next to us, and the reason why they're all out in the open is for safety. They can find if they are out in the open. This is a bachelor herd. Viam and I just noticed that earlier. It's only males. That's not unusual. Often you'll find males together and the females with a few dominant males perhaps within that herd until the rutting season. Then these males will challenge each other and try and set up a small territory that they may keep a group of females in that territory and mate with them. But through the rest of the year, they will mate and they will stay together like this in bachelor herds. The mating season, or April and May, and that's when the males will fight and they snort and they run around and they try and show off to attract females. Really is a beautiful, beautiful morning. Great to start with possibly there was some elephant. I'm going to head into that area and see if we can't find them. Let's go and have a look. I do see some fresh elephant dung along the road here and fresh tracks. Big track. So James has gone to the south of Juma this morning. He's working around an area looking while I'm looking for elephant. Why don't you go over to James and let him say good morning to you.
Good morning, and welcome to this part of the Starlings. They are saying hello to you all. My name is James. I'm not a starling. I'm a human being, sort of. And David is on camera today. He's wearing gloves that I last wore when I had a BMX. That was when I was six. A bearded woodpecker there. Unfortunately, it flew off because Byron was blethering on for so long as you came across to us. Hashtags of... 1 second. There are hyenas calling from... Beautiful morning. So we are as live as Byron. Hashtags for our live questions at wildearth.tv. It would be good to hear from you during the course of the morning. We have come down here just seeing if we could find some female leopard tracks. Karula's tracks have headed east around here to see if we can't perhaps pick up tracks of Sindile, our favourite little male leopard, 20 years old he is. His collar has stopped pinging, and that means the batteries have gone flat, so it's probably not too long before it falls off. And then we'll have to track in the old-fashioned way. So that's what we're doing out here now. It is a don't look quite as impressive as they do when the sun is actually shining upon them. All right, David, here we go. It is quite cold, as Byron said, but the weather report says it's 10 degrees so far. This is a patent untruth. It is not the coldest day of the year so far, so I'm not sure exactly where that weather report comes from, which work of fiction it has been derived. Effluent tracks. The effluents have been all over the place at the moment. So with any luck, that will continue into the sort of really dry season. And just look at the landscape now, remember it, take a mental picture. In months or so's time, this golden sheen that covers the trees, largely the bush willow trees, which are the dominant species here, that will change, of course, because there will all just be sticks sticking out of the ground. Quite used to this sort of landscape, and things will be a little tough for those who have chosen to live a life of herbivory. I'm going to stop at many different things this morning. Some little ones there on the ground, Davey, just fossicking around under the tree, because I just think that it's always worth stopping to listen in the mornings. And they're still making, I don't know if you know the sound that day-old chicks make. I'm sure you've all seen those day-old chicks, those little yellow chickens. And that rather delightful sound they make, that sort of whistling. Naturally, they've stopped doing it now. I don't know where, I think they seem to have left their parents. And the Franklins, quite interestingly, in fact, and I don't really understand this, so I'm going to look it up right now. They give, or they had their clutches quite late. I mean, they've only three weeks ago. Now that's the middle of winter, and a Franklin is ostensibly a seed eater and insect eater, so you'd expect it to have babies, I would have thought, during the summer months. Breeding, monogamous, solitary nester, males compete for mates, yes, yes, blah, blah. Laying dates, October to March. That's interesting. So we've had some late ones. That's really interesting, actually. When the rain is, there are insects and their seeds around. These ones around here, this is not the only clutch. Those Franklins are probably about 3 weeks old. Okay, let's head across to Byron. He's got something large to have a look at.
Elephant. So I've managed to find the culprits of the cracking branches. Herd of elephant. Oh, look at that youngster. They are so, so great to watch. Always playful and learning. It's incredible. Looks like quite a substantial herd, but they are a very, very cute youngster. cow's trying to use its feet. A little root or something on the ground, and it's trying to feed on. Look at that. A youngster like that doesn't really know how to use its trunk. Really work out how to use that trunk properly. So in the meantime, it'll be watching its mother and the other elephant in the herd trying to learn. That is so cute. Trying to listen, and it sounds like Vierman and I just sounded like we heard some alarm calls. There was an elephant bellowing in the distance. I don't think that was an alarm call, possibly just an elephant. Heard one or two snorts from an impala. That is their alarm call, so that's a call that they give if they are any predators around that might threaten them. And the impala will alarm call that round, and they need to be on the lookout. Don't hear it again. Don't think it was a serious alarm call. Going to see if more of these elephants come out. James has got a sunrise to show you.
Lights Our World has just come up in the east. Now it is a little bit south of east, and due east will probably be sort of a frame away from the left hand side of your picture. I just thought we'd come and have a quick look at this before you go back to the elephants. Isn't that pretty? I've taken a rank average photograph of it already. Leaves. There it is. All right, let's go back to Byron and his elephants.
James loves watching sunrise and sunset, and I must have it's just behind them, but these two little ones are exploring and playing. Look at that. And some of you might be wondering, are these twins? They are not. They do appear to be of similar age. It's purely by their size. Just going to try reverse a little bit because there is a beautiful large here, hold on. But how wonderful is this? A great start. Heard of elephant. I love watching elephants. I can watch them for hours. I'm certain that is one of the mothers. She has large mammary glands under the front legs. Can you see that? So I'm sure one of those youngsters would be suckling from her at the moment. You're just reaching up with the trunk, The trunk is such a great tool for the elephant. Tearing off some of those little branches. But the incredible thing is that is a thorn tree or an acacia tree. Very, very sharp thorns. But it doesn't stop the elephant from feeding on those leaves. They've got very thick skin, a thick hide. Really is amazing. You can see this is a wonderful profile of this female elephant. And if you have a look at her head or her forehead, you can look at that very, very angular at the top. And that is an easy way to identify a female or a male. The male elephant have a very rounded forehead. Quite a square, angular shaped head. Also, with herds like this, it is the females with the younger elephant. The big dominant males don't often move on estrus, and then those males will hang around and try to mate with them. Once they do that, they move off again. Look at that, those very, very sharp thorns, but that does not stop the elephant. They'll feed on just about anything. They've got a lot of molars and premolars in their mouth that grind down the plants or the trees that they eat, or the nutrients from the food that they eat. And the rest is passed through in their dung. And that's why elephant dung is very, very coarse. A lot of plant material that hasn't been broken down properly, but they are bulk feeders. That is why they're constantly feeding. Obviously need a lot of fuel to keep large bodies like that going. So Mary Ann has asked us an interesting question about these female elephants. Mary Ann would like to know why the mammary gland situated. Mary Ann, I don't know, to tell you the truth. You know, that's the way they've evolved. I don't know if there's a specific reason. I know with buffalo, and the reason for that, I know, helps the calves suckle while the buffalo are moving. The calves will move right behind and suckle between the back legs, but the buffalo can still move. And, you know, often when they're standing in the feeding, standing and feeding, the calves will come up and suckle. But I don't know if it's got a specific reason to it, to tell you the truth. It's an interesting question, Marianne. And, you know, some of these questions, I'm not sure how much of it is actually proven. So Roger's asked us a question. What is the general age for an elephant to become weaned off of its mother? So Roger, I've seen calves still try to suckle at the age of about 4 from mothers. But they start feeding on plant material from a year and a half. They've already started to feed on plant material. But they do milk. So I have seen young elephant that, as I said, are quite old, 4 or 5 years, 6 years old, that are still trying. So Michael is saying, Michael, I've never seen elephant giving birth to twins or heard of it. And I'm trying to think if it does happen. Very difficult for an elephant to raise such a large calf and have another one. I haven't heard of a situation where twins are born. These two that we have seen here that are similar age belong to different females. They don't belong to the one female. I'm 100% certain of that, because one is following a female there. So I'm not too sure about twins with elephant. I've never heard of it and I've never seen it. I don't think it happens very often, if at all. We are starting to get some of that sunlight coming through now. Really beautiful morning, very, very peaceful morning. Elephant now, let them carry on with their breakfast, walking about, enjoying the vegetation. Let's cross back to my friend James and see what he's up to.
We haven't seen one mammal. We will be lucky. I know, I can feel it in my bones though, don't worry.
Tracks?
They are mostly of an age that you could probably call them fossils at this stage, so nothing worth following at this stage. Herbert, I have had no update from, so I can only assume this is tracking of age. Anyway, we live in hope. Now, what she did yesterday, if anyone's wondering, the Queen of Juma, our 300 meters, a quarter of a mile to the north of where we are now, in a tree, and they stayed there for the whole day, sleeping. And then, sometime during the night, she came back to fetch them. She took them out the tree in the early evening yesterday, and she's probably headed off to take them to the next thing that she's killed. That's generally how the movement works. They love to sit in the first rays of the sun. You can just see the golden sun catching them there. Now watch them. Watch. I so enjoyed that. In the background, a southern boo-boo. Let's just listen to this while we wait for... See if he does the display again. Max Mum, you want to know if it's true or... Now, that might sound utterly outlandish to many of you, but Max Mum, it absolutely is true. In the distance, if you hear a zebra calling, it does sound a little bit like, I think it's more the red-billed horse. You'd never mistake them standing next to you for a hornbill, but in the distance, yes, they can sound like hornbills. Just look how the sun catches him. His little feathers have gone very gold. Right, good, David, that was a nice sight. Better than that. We're heading down towards Twin Dams Road now, which is a little chilly. Now, as I was means is to kill something, go and fetch the cubs, they share the kill for a while, and then she normally moves off from the kill site, stashes them in. It's quite interesting as to why she wouldn't leave them, for example, yesterday there. They killed it, or she killed it. The three of them ate it. She moved away from that area, stashed them in a tree, and she went off, I think, to hunt again. Awesome, force. Very important if you happen to be a solitary female leopard. And then disappear off, or she'll take them away again, stash them somewhere, and walk off and have her alone time and kill again. And that's the rhythm of life. I wish we were spending a little bit more time with Shadow and her new little cub. But hopefully soon. Old Joe, you say. You want me to do my hyena impersonation again because it made your wife giggle? Well, Mrs. Donald Joe. Thank you, Louise. Louise says it sounded just like a hyena. Plenty of tracks of elephants around the place, as I said earlier. just have a quick look here. There's a bit likely to get smacked by a warthog. I don't think there's a warthog in there, but let's have a look. I think he'd have come out already. Hello? Hello? No, no warthogs in there. I can see that there are unfresh or some old tracks, possibly, so it's not very neatly kept. Now this grass is going to become a very, very precious commodity fairly soon. It's sitting on a termite mound. That means it's going to be nutritious. And although it's quite strong, so I think you'll find that this last bits of what we call Chlorus roxbergiana, or the feathered chlorus, are going to be extremely important sources of... You can never be too sure. Very pretty though. Blanky on leggies. And on we go. It's elephants.
I'm glad James has given up climbing. Found anything else just yet. Been looking around, there's some impala. It sounded like a female's close by. It wasn't actually alarm calling. Often, you see, the males are clever. They'll snort like that once or twice. It sounds like an them to where they want. Ooh, down, all the cold air is still sitting there and gets quite cold. While I'm driving, I'm also looking for tracks of any animals we might want to see. Started the Kruger National Park and declared it a national park. Tim would like to know, did the animals that we see today occur here naturally, Tim? All these animals were around. With the start of the national park though, they were just better protected. But the animals have always been a zebra. Recently, and animals have been reintroduced into areas. Oh, there's some just off to the right. Moss that they can find here. It is very dry at the moment. But he was saying there are a number of game reserves throughout South Africa, Southern Africa, that basically reclaimed old farmlands. They've tried to re-establish the area and reintroduce wildlife that may have been found there before the farming. So there are game reserves like that, but with the Kruger National Park, these animals have always been here, always been around, and the populations now, obviously with it being a protected national park, have just increased and they are doing very, very well. Zebra just moving off. We're sitting with the zebra, but James...
Indeed I have, everybody. It's a hyena on patrol. She was jogging. He was jogging down the road towards us. And so we're just going to see what he does. We're right on the southern boundary now. Let's just see what he does. I think it's one of the males from our little clan. And definitely something is on the wind. He smelt something. To the south. But I don't know where exactly he's going. There he goes. Stopped. He's listening. But he was... might just be walking around us, you know. He may have smelt something deep inside there, or much further east of here, west of here. Forever, basically. They've got an amazing stamina. uncomfortable clay spot there. I'm going to turn around, everyone. There's a bit of noise behind us. We'll go sort of parallel with him. Looking, walks into the sticks, lionesses and their babies. You know, they're very out here. Is us. Gone. I think there's, sorry about that, everybody, we're just with the road. There, if you like. It's such fun to watch this time of the find these trails from water.
Great, so James and a hyena, that's fantastic. To see if we can't get a glimpse of those cubs. I haven't seen them yet, they've been hiding every time we've got there. We're not too far from them. Viam and I would like to go and have a look, see if we can't find. Morning has been great so far, great start. Elephant, zebra, impala. Nice to just drive quietly and listen and scan. Oh. Let's have a look quickly. Let's just see if Viam has seen something over here. Let me jump off quickly and have a look. Stay with us, everyone. Let's see what we got. A lot of zebra.
See this one?
A zebra, all zebra tracks around here. Anyway, it was worth having a good look. We some activity around there. I hope so. Sun's coming out, so it's warming up quite nicely. We may get. Ellie, thank you for asking. Good morning to you. Ellie, I am heading off to Londolozi, which is taking them there on safari for about a week, which is going to be really nice too. A lot of impala around here. It's interesting because we are right. So yes, Ellie, Londolozi for a few days with guests and then back to Johannesburg again. That is where I live, to get to the bush when I need to go. It's not too far. We can either drive up or fly up to the greater Kruger area. Or where? That's interesting. No sign of hyena, just impala. So we've got to the hyena den, and we have found it. Look at that young male. See the horns, very, very young. But Ellie, getting back to your question, I'm sure I will be coming back to Safari Live sometime soon, again, to help out whenever they need this week, and it's been fantastic, been a lot of fun. Great spending time with the team, and especially James. He's a good friend of mine. We go way back, well, a few years, and so it's really great to spend time in the bush and guiding with one another, and enjoying a bit of the banter and finding stuff together. It's been great. Yeah, so no hyena at the hyena den. Binging, probably moving around. They would have been moving around quite a bit during the evening. The reason for that is they generally are nocturnal. They prefer scavenging. But in this area, they most likely wanted to find leopard or light densite a little bit later. While I'm making my way out of the area of this densite.
Woohoo! Impala at the hyena den. Good stuff. it's more than we found. At least we found a hyena. That was quite good of us. He disappeared to the south of us. We followed him for a while, and then he disappeared further. So we looked up over the hill where I thought I had heard a noise. The noise I heard, I thought was perhaps game drives looking at lions in the area. They were driving around, but I didn't see anything. So nothing was there. We're now on the far eastern boundary. We're going to head north towards Beefles Hook Dam and see what we can find that side. Gorilla's tracks were heading this way. I've heard nothing further from Herbert, so I can but assume that he has not been successful just yet. It is a glorious morning, but we are driving very slowly because it is still quite chilly, especially down by Twin Dams where we were there. David is basically hidden beneath various head adornments that are warming up his bonds. Elephant tracks here, naturally they are heading out of where the reserve is. That is irritating, especially if you haven't seen anything yet. You might have to stop and have a listen shortly. Let's stop and have a listen, everybody. When in doubt, stop and have a listen. Just Franklin's tick-a-doo, 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 tick-a-doo. You can also hear a few white-browed scrub robins, a couple of red-faced mouse birds going tick-a-doo, tick-a-doo, tick-a-doo. Beautiful. It is so nice. The first sun rays touch your face, I have to tell you. There's some waterbuck up ahead. Let's go and have a quick look at them. I think they've headed off into the bushes though. Elias. More hyena tracks. There are two kinds of people in the world, everyone. Some who can say hyena and those who cannot. Now, the word hyena, as that's how you're supposed to say it, has only got one H in it, and that is the first word of the first letter of the word. That's an H. The waterbuck have disappeared in there, I'm afraid. And many in the world are unable to accept this, and they say hyena. But why that should be the case, I don't really know. So you need to decide which person, what kind of a person you are. Are you a hyena or are you a hyena? And are you able to say hyena? we have had in the past and currently a few directors who are unable to let go of the second H. It is a psychological imbalance that they have. I don't know what it's indicative of. Rebecca, for example, cannot say hyena. Louise manages hyena. Tara Dales, who many of you will remember, who's now working in Johannesburg, she used to say hyena. She was unable, despite her very large intellect, to say hyena. David, say?
Hyena.
There we go. Dave is one of the correct school. Hyena. No. Hyena. Hyena. No, there's no H in it, Rebecca. Okay. Hyena. No! That's basically what we talk about in camp all day. Hopefully find you an animal talk about that rather. Roger, Roger, you want to know about hyenas and alarm calls, and does it elicit alarm calls from animals? Now, that's a very good question. It doesn't always, but sometimes it does. So, Roger, if the hyena are definitely on the hunt, if you like, if they are clearly sort of circling around some impala, if there are a few of them, if there are a few of them obviously sort of looking to get a meal, then impala will alarm call at them. Often not very enthusiastically, often they'll just give a sort of half-hearted snort or two, but if it's very clear that the hyena are hunting, then they will. Sometimes if it's a lone hyena like that male we saw there, they might just look up, just check what's going on and then carry on with their eating. This is the impala. So yeah, sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. Wild dogs, they don't bother, they just run away as fast as they can. Leopard, lion, they will absolutely alarm call. Things like big pythons as well, that makes impala shout an alarm call. But it's leopards and lions largely that make the animals out here alarm. Sometimes hyena, but it's just not that frequent. It's very obvious when a hyena is hunting and when it is just sort of running from one place to scavenge to the next. That hyena we saw there was very clearly on his way to find something to steal. He'd heard or smelt something in the wind. All right, I'm going to not talk about hyenas any further. We're hopefully going to find an animal to show you. While we do that, let's go and find out what Byron has been doing with the car.
James, thank you for the lesson in pronouncing hyena. We are in search of the other den site. Viem has told me there were one or two other hyena den sites around that have been used in the past, so we just want to go have a look. Very curious to see, maybe there is a little bit of activity around there. Let's find the road quickly, which we need to take. Saw something back there. What a great morning. This is that area we saw the elephant this morning. Seem to have moved off. Really, really beautiful morning. Starting to warm up a bit. Maybe the gloves will get taken off soon. While I try and find out where this hyena den is, the old hyena den. James has got a bird around, I think.
Bird around, I'm not sure what that means. There is a bird, and it looks like a dove to you, I'm sure, and I'm afraid we can't get any closer with the zoom. It isn't a dove, just listen to it calling. Obviously it's not going to call now. If it starts calling again, I'll shut up. It's a shikra, there. cool, eh? The Shikra is a little sort of sparrow hawky type bird. Used to be known as a little banded goshawk. And so it eats all sorts of other little birds. And it's obviously territorially marking there. And that's not the most impressive shot of a Shikra. But they do have the most beautiful red eyes. Now remember I said to you, it's always a good idea to stop and listen. Well, that has just borne some fruit for us, because on the right-hand side of the car is an elephant. Unfortunately, it is in Torchwood, so we cannot get any closer to it. But can you see it there, Dave? There is the elephant. Oh, they're shouting at each other. It's a whole herd in there. There we go. Look at the colours of the grey and the gold there. Copper, I suppose. Grey and copper. Two of them. We'll see if they don't decide that they wish to... It's a very odd noise one of them's making. Very strange, actually. Is one of them on a termite mound there, Dov? I think it must be. See how high up he is? I don't think he's that massive. I think he's on a termite mound. That's quite interesting. They are amazing climbers, elephants. Shall I go back a little bit? Say when. Oh, yes, he is. He's right on top of a termite mound. Look at that. He's not quite fully grown. I mean, they never get fully grown. They grow till they die, but not quite an adult, I don't think. I'll look with my binoculars. That's a pretty big cow, I think, standing atop an enormous termite mound. And eating what's called a common falsethorn, Albizia harveyi. Very good elephant forage. And they don't grow big, those trees. They don't get any more than scraggly bushes like the one he's macerating now. Because the elephants so enjoy them. Very heavily pregnant. I don't know, you probably can't tell from this picture, you can't. I can see with my binoculars she's got quite a severe bump at her rear end. She will probably climb down off the termite mound and reveal herself to be a he, but as far as I can tell from here, that's what's going on there. Hungry, David? David's stomach is making very loud grumbling noises.
Thanks, James.
Mine will begin shortly. There's another elephant climbing up to the top of the mound now. Look at that. It's a young one trying to suckle, so it's definitely a female. Much too old to be suckling. And look, you know what he's doing? That young one is also biting the soil there. Hello, shiny. That could be interpreted in 100 different ways. Shiny. Louise, please give us the spelling of that. Shiny, you want to know... S-H-Y-N-E-E. Okay, this is a shiny here. Shiny, you want to know about whether or not elephants will allo-suckle, i.e. will they suckle each other's youngsters? They can. It's not necessarily something they choose to do particularly frequently, but they do it. And certainly if the elephant calf is orphaned, then another cow will take over and nurse the young one. So there is an element of allo-suckling. I don't think it's quite as frequent or as ubiquitous as it is with lions. lions do it all the time. It is so funny seeing them just perched on top of their little termite mound there. That poor Albizia tree thought, I found a safe spot up here. No elephant will climb up a little mound like this. Well, not so. Alrighty, well, I think we'll leave these elephants. They're quite far away. Let's head up. We're still on the eastern boundary here, and we're heading up towards Bevorsuk Dam. We'll see what we can find back here. It was very nice of the elephants to pitch up while we were looking at the Shukra, a little banded goshawk, which has flown off to go and eat some small birds. It's always with a slight tang of sadness that one says that on a day like this when it is so peaceful and lovely to be out, thinking that were I a yellow-bellied eremomala, or perhaps a yellow-fronted canary, that Shikra might grab me from behind and destroy me. Horrible way to spend such a lovely morning. All right, let's go back across to Byron and see what he's managed to find.
So I haven't found anything yet, James, but I'm looking just to get my bearings. We here where this old densite is, was. Let's have a look. Let's try and get in here quickly. The old hyena densite. Let's see what we can find. We just need to be careful. Our aerial is a little bit loose on the back. Got a lot of trees around here. Was it this one right here, Vim? Okay. Doesn't look like there's any activity around here. Just scan the area carefully. I don't see anything. But it was just worth coming to have a look. You never know, they could move between den sites. They do change den sites depending on how busy the den site has been. And the reason for that is occasionally they get a lot of fleas and little mites that bite them. Obviously, you can imagine with the youngsters in the den, but I think those other cubs are too young to be moved yet. So I don't think they will move dens just yet. Maybe within a month or so, they could decide to change. There's also no guarantee that they will definitely change den sites. They could stay there until those cubs are old enough to move around with the clan. It all depends. But always worth having a look around and just checking. Looks like James was the only one who found hyena this morning so far. And he didn't even go to a den site. It's not fair. Okay, let's see if I can get out of here quickly. James has suggested I try the den site of a road called Galago. I may just do that, James. So let me just get out of here. It's not that easy with all the branches around and the aerials. But I have managed. There are some hyena tracks around here, but there's no sign of the actual hyena. This is fun. I enjoy doing this. You're just looking around. You don't know what you're going to bump into. Nick from Michigan has asked us if elephant ever harass or kill hyena. I've never seen an elephant kill a hyena, but I think what will happen is if a hyena get too close to the elephant, they will chase him, definitely. Elephant don't like other animals coming too close, especially predators. The herd of elephant will charge up and chase away lions, leopard, hyena, any predator that comes into their environment or close to them. I've seen herds of elephant charge lions often and chase them away. Never seen them kill a hyena though, but I just assume they would do the same like they do to the lions and will chase the hyena. I don't think the elephant would be able to catch the hyena. If they do run off, they are very fast, and they'll probably just keep a wide berth of the elephant anyway and stay out of their way. Some buffalo dung around, elephant dung. We've been very lucky the last few days. The last 2 days, James and I have had amazing game drives. We've seen so much, been able to show you so much. Cheetah, wild dog, and lions, leopard with cubs, elephant herds, buffalo herds. We've seen so much. It's been incredible. Really, really very fortunate. Siberian Mimi would like to know what other animals are on my bucket list, animals I would still like to see. I think right up on the bucket list I would say is the snow leopard. I'd love to see a snow leopard and have to get up into that area at some point. And then what else? I'd like to do a bit of North America and just see, you know, try and see bears, that would be great. Polar bears in the Antarctic. What else? And jaguars in the Pantanal, in South America. Get down to South America, I think that would be wonderful to see and try and experience. Saw some lion tracks this morning earlier, but they weren't fresh tracks, they were about a day old at least. I think it was the lionesses that we had a day or two ago, 2 days ago we had the lionesses, the day before, the days all roll into 1 year. The day before we had the lions on a kill right outside, or very close to camp. And those lionesses were chased off by two males. I think those tracks that we saw earlier this morning were from those lionesses. Moved up to our northern boundary, or the boundary with Biffle's Hook. And they hung around that area, and I think they crossed over into that territory. Scanning carefully through the thickets while we're driving. I always think, you know, while we're speaking, we possibly miss quite a lot. Not looking carefully enough. I mean, if a lion or a leopard was lying down in the long grass, there's no long grass at the moment, but even just lying under a tree, very difficult to see them, and I don't think we would be able to if you're driving too quickly. Leopard tracks around here yesterday morning, fresh leopard tracks. We were just unable to find him. We drove along this road, there were no tracks, and we came back a little bit late in the morning and the tracks were on top of our vehicle tracks, and headed straight past camp, but nobody saw the leopard. Yeah, I think those are the tracks for him that we saw. Yeah. Those are the tracks from yesterday. Followed them all along that road. It's amazing how they can just disappear if they want to. A leopard, I've, in my experience in tracking and following leopard, if they do not want to be seen, you are not going to see them. They can disappear in seconds. They're amazing. Vim, which direction is that other den site? Is it along that way? Okay. Getting directions from Vim. He knows the area a bit better than me. He's been here longer than me. So Brian has asked us a question. Do male leopards live longer than female leopards? Brian, no. Generally not. Generally not. Generally, female leopards will live longer than males. The average lifespan is between, I'd say, 15 and 17 years for a female leopard. For a male leopard, it's probably around 12 to 15 years. They're similar, but generally females do live a lot longer. The thing is, often what happens is when dominant male leopards, when they become old, they will get challenged by other male leopards for their territory. And often what happens is they get into fights, and those fights could injure them quite badly, and they may die from that. So the life expectancy of a male leopard is far less than a female leopard. Okay, I'm going to head towards this old hyena den site. Let's just have a look around this area. While I do that, cross over to James and see what he's up to.
I'm intrigued by the whereabouts of the hyenas, I must say. Like I said earlier, or a little while back, I think you'll find that that low-ranking female went to that den site simply because it was away from the other dominants, and the others are probably still, unfortunately, on some bambili. So maybe those cubs she's decided are old enough to take to the central den now, and maybe that's what she's done. Anyway, we found some relatively fresh male leopard tracks coming down this way. So we're just going to go towards Biffleshook Dam and see if he hasn't popped up there. He did go down into the drainage line to the left of where your screen, and it's not possible to get a vehicle in there at all. So it was almost pointless going down there. But I don't think the tracks were from early this morning. I think they were from last night sometime. So he would have walked quite far. It was very clearly a territorial marking that he was doing. He left an enormous pile of dung on the road, which was very nice of him. Very obvious that he'd been there. So he was definitely marking territory, quite possibly Tingana, our dominant male leopard. Otherwise, David and I have seen nothing. Not one mammal. We just had reports from cheetah plains, from Andrew and Mike, who are sounding increasingly desperate on the radio. They too have found nothing. Aubrey doesn't seem to be out today. I can't raise Herbert on the radio. So everything seems to be well and truly asleep this morning. Oh. What is that, David? Is that the male leopard again? Let me just have a look here, everybody. We may have been to the dam and turned round. In which case, no, that's a lioness. This be a lioness. She be going that way. Let's go check the dam quickly, and then we'll come back and have a look here. They go off down there, and there's a road down there. We can go down there. Unfortunately, Wendy will have no signal, but if we find a lion, we can send Byron there. I'm rusty. Well, at least we have some tracks. That's a good thing. It means there were things around here. Shamsan, nice question from you.
Was that Holdo speaking?
Shamsan, I'm just getting a little confused about Wendy's signal at the moment. Shamsun, a good one for me about tracking. You say if animals run, do they leave less obvious tracks? It depends entirely on the substrate that they run on. So if they run through sand or sort of obviously soft soil, no, they don't leave less sign at all. They actually leave more obvious signs because they spray soil out. The tracks are less distinct, but they're very definitely clear and very obvious. Obviously, they land more heavily when they're running. On rocky ground or on rockier ground, harder ground, it can be more difficult to see their tracks because the tracks are further apart. They're spaced further apart, which makes it a little difficult to work out what was going on. It's quite nice. Now, we know that there's a lioness around here that's got cubs, so we might be very lucky with that. But that, I think, would be tempting fate too much on a day like today when the top sighting we've had has been of a shikra sitting in a tree disguising itself as a dove. I suppose we did have a hyena as well, and an elephant. It is starting to warm up, as Byron says. It's always the delightful part of the morning. But I've got to tell you, just to sit and be silent for a while is the best healing balm on a day like today. Still awake, David?
Oh, yes.
David is still awake, everybody. He's lucky. Hello, James in Texas. You're interested in how many animals in this area or in this park are close to being extinct. Well, as a species, James, there are a few endangered ones. We look at wild dogs. They are certainly endangered, and very distressingly, an entire pack was wiped out the other day by canine distemper, domestic dog disease that really does create a major issue for animals here. Then we've got black rhino. Black rhino are an obvious example of an endangered species. They are about only 4,000 of them left in the world. Wild dogs are only about 2,500. So those are the two most obvious ones. There's absolutely nothing going on here at all. Let me just move into the middle so I can see down the drainage. There we are. We'll just catch the morning breeze. So this is Biffles Hook Dam. Of course, the hippopotamus is not here. The sun is shining very brightly off the surface of the water. James, I think those are the two most obvious ones. There are a number of birds, like the ground hornbill that is endangered. Enormous turkey-like blackbird. And I'm trying to think of any other mammals. I don't think there are any mammals that are endangered. There are many that are threatened, though. Lions, leopards, cheetah, elephants now, white rhino, all threatened because we as human beings are too idiotic to see their intrinsic value. Beautiful little scene, I must say, very peaceful indeed. Those are Egyptian geese you're looking at there. No sign of the male leopard. Joey, you're wondering about yellow-billed storks and whether we've ever seen them at Juma. We have, you know, we've actually seen them at this dam. I'll show you a picture, everybody, of a yellow-billed stork. There aren't any at the moment, and they're certainly migratory as far as I remember. Joey, that's quite an interesting bird question that you've asked there. I'm wondering if you've ever been out here, and if not, it's probably about time that you organise a trip. There's the yellow-billed stork. They're not common here, but they certainly can be found sometimes. And they're resident and visitor, which means some of them migrate and some of them do not. But we don't find them often here. They're like wetter areas, basically. Floodplains, large rivers, estuaries and lakes, rather than small dams in the middle of fairly semi-arid areas. But in good rain years, you'll definitely see them. And I seem to remember we had one or two here at Buffelsoek Dam during the rainy season last year, which wasn't very rainy at all. Right, we're going to go to the top of the dam wall here, turn around, and then we're going to go down towards where those lion tracks were heading. They'll probably converge on the leopard tracks. The two of them will be lying very comfortably next to each other, sharing their breakfast, cubs playing all over the place. It's definitely what's going to happen. Watch this. Here we go, Dave. You ready for that?
Yes.
I am too. I'm deeply ready for any kind of action. Shall we go down the lower road? Let's try the lower road. The dam wall may collapse underneath us, in which case, you know, it's been a good time. Thanks. Now, we don't lose signal here anymore, of course. We used to lose signal because we'd go down through the drainage and up the other side. Now, of course, there's a wall that would undoubtedly stop Noah's flood, and so that is no longer a problem for us. And if you're wondering why the dams have been modified and why they're so big, well, the answer is thought, if you like, that says there's going to be severe flood here. Long term, in the same way that I did with the purchase of stocks and shares, for example. I think it's so much of it is utterly beyond our understanding. So we might be lucky. All right, let's go back to Byron quickly and get an update from him. I will attempt to find something more exciting than the sound of my own voice.
Thank you, James. Yes, I hope you have some luck too. We haven't had any luck yet. Good morning, though, to Madam O'Connell and Madam Creel from Rodin and to the Grade 1 girls. Lovely to have you with us again. We are trying to find something, anything this morning. I was looking for hyena, but no luck just yet. James saw a hyena briefly this morning. He only got to see one. I went to the den site where the little cubs are, but the adults aren't there. And I think the little cubs are still sleeping inside. Myself and VM are driving around looking very, very carefully for any signs of animals. So glad you young girls get to go on a game drive with us so early in the morning. Hopefully we'll find something interesting to show you. Don't forget to ask your teachers to send us the questions that you might have. Such a beautiful tree in front of us. Just want to have a look. This is called a torchwood tree. I want to see if I can find a seed. I don't think I will be able to. It's very dry at the moment. A little dacre just ran off in through the thicket over there. Gave me a little bit of a fright. Always got to be careful when you jump out of a car. Have a look around. Make sure there are no animals hiding. So I've been looking for the seed of a torchwood. And I know James has tried it before. We haven't been too successful in the past. But it gets its name, torchwood, from the seed and the oil that is in the seed. What happens is, apparently, if you take a seed and you crush it open and you get the liquid that's inside the seed, you can use it to help light a fire. I haven't been lucky enough for it to work for me. I know James has tried before and I don't think he has any luck. You can maybe ask him a little bit about it later. But just such a beautiful tree. That stem, very, very distinct stem. It looks very different to the other trees around here. Do you see how it appears as if the whole stem is twisted? and curled around. It's a very, very beautiful tree. It has got sharp thorns on it, and it's not easy to climb. I know James likes to climb trees, but I don't think James would like to climb this tree. Come on, VM, we need some luck now. We need to find something. I've got a good feeling. Scan these beautiful open areas. Alyssa has asked us, are there any hippos around? They're just some beautiful birds, Alyssa. Sorry, I just want to try and show you in this little tree. There we go. White-crested helmet shrike. Look at that beautiful yellow eye. Wow, that is a wonderful bird. You can see them, there they are. White-crested helmet shrikes. They are very, very beautiful little birds, and always in family groups. There's quite a few of them around here. Look at the light on that beautiful bird. Oh, fantastic. There they go. Oh, wonderful. It's always nice to see new little bird species that we get flying around, especially the smaller ones. They're very interesting that you don't often get to see, but those white-crested helmet shrikes are always in little family groups, so you can easily find 4, 6, or 8 of them together, and they fly in little flocks from one tree to the next. Lovely to see them. Alyssa, getting back to your question about the hippo, there are hippo around, and I've seen a lot of tracks this morning too. The hippo move around and they eat grass during the evenings. Then usually what they do is they return back to the water during the day. Now, James is at Biffle's Hook Dam and he's been looking around for any sign of animals around there, but he can't seem to find a hippo. So perhaps that hippo is still out eating somewhere and may return back to that dam a little bit later. So Sasha has asked us a very interesting question. Sasha would like to know, do the hyena hunt for themselves or do they only steal food from other predators? So Sasha, the hyena definitely do hunt for themselves. They have to, otherwise they're not going to eat that often. We don't often get to see them hunting though, and we generally only see hyena when they are stealing or trying to steal food from other predators like leopard and lion. But, oh, I see a warthog. Oh, I hope he stays standing for us. Hold on a second. Let me try to show you. Where has he gone? I think he has run off. There he is. Wait. I can still just see him. There we go, let's see. There he goes. Did you see that little tail pop up as he ran off? So the warthog, whenever they run, they stick their tail up in the air and they run off very quickly. Now, the theory behind that is that the warthog use their tails to see each other in the long grass, and they follow the tail so they can see the tail, and then they'll follow each other away from danger. So whenever they run, they stick the tail up and they run very, very quickly. An old Shangaan friend of mine who is a tracker in this area used to tell a funny story. He would say that when the warthog run away from something, they run so fast that they squint their eyes. You know, if you get wind blowing in your face and you squint your eyes a little bit, And they run so fast that they squint their eyes because the wind is blowing in their face. But because their skin is so tight that when they squint their eyes, the skin pulls really tight and makes the tail go up. But that's not the case. That's not the case at all. So Sasha, getting back to your question again with the hyena and hunting, they do hunt for themselves, especially in other parts of Africa, maybe where there are not so many predators like lion or leopard. They will hunt as just as much as those animals. But in this area, there's lots of lions, there's lots of leopards, so it's easier for them to try and steal food from those animals. But you are right, they do hunt for themselves. Seen a little antelope, and it is running off. There we go. Look at that, a beautiful little steenbok. Very, very small antelope. Look how difficult that is to see. Oh, look here, there's a hornbill, and it's got a worm. Look at that, everybody. It's got a caterpillar. Well spotted, VM. He saw the hornbill. It's a beautiful yellow-billed hornbill. But look at that. Oh, and it's finished. Just as quickly as that. See, it was using its beak, that very long yellow beak, to hit the caterpillar on the stick or on the tree. And that is to kill the worm or the caterpillar. And then just open its beak and throw it down the hatch. Nice bit of breakfast for the hornbill. And off it goes. Wow, that was amazing. That was really great. Fantastic to see how different animals need to get food. We're speaking about hyena, how they steal food from other animals or in the hunt. And then a hornbill caught a caterpillar right next to us. That is really, really special. Let's go back to my friend James and see what he's up to, and maybe he has a hippo in the dam, I'm not too sure.
Good morning, good morning, the little girls of Madam Creel and Madam McConnell's class this morning. I hope you're all very well, and a special, special welcome to Krithika Patha, whose father is a very good friend of mine. Krithika, thank you for your message last night. I hope that you're enjoying our little safari this morning. Now, one of the things that you must never do, of course, in the wilderness is touch too much poo. I've got two kinds of poo here to show you, and it's a bit disgusting, I suppose you might think, but it's not too bad because this poo, of course, has been very dried, and it's only grass. It's from herbivores. We would never pick up the poo of, say, a lion or a hyena because that would be disgusting. Look inside there, and you can see there, this is very old buffalo dung, and this very old buffalo dung is very finely chewed. The buffalo like to chew their food very well. And what people used to do out here, and still do in some rural areas, is you can use buffalo dung to cover the walls of your house. So your homes are covered with cement. You can use buffalo dung if that's all you've got. And you won't believe it, but it smells really nice. My name is James. On camera is Dave, and Dave likes to smell things in the bush as well. Have a smell of that, Dave.
Thanks, James.
Not bad, is it?
Not bad at all.
I bet you didn't think that you were going to learn about good smelling poo when you came on Game Drive with us this morning. Now, yesterday I said to you all that we were very, very lucky because we saw cheetah and we saw lions and we saw elephants and we saw all sorts of different things. Today is much more quiet, and that's just how it happens in the wilderness. Now, let's look at this elephant dung. Can you see the difference? See the different things that elephants eat? They eat lots of different kinds of things. They eat wood, There's lots of wood in there. That's a big twig from what we call a buffalo thorn tree. There's a leaf. Now this leaf, look at the size of this leaf. It's come through the elephant almost without being chewed. So it just swallowed the leaf whole. See that? And you can also see here what season it is. See, that's an autumn leaf or a winter leaf. You can see that it's brown. It's not green anymore. So elephants eat lots of different kinds of things. Wood and leaves and grass and pods and fruits. And they're really good soccer balls if you don't have a soccer ball. Now, while you were with Byron looking at that hornbill, we heard a lion calling just over there. And it was going, oh, 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 oh. Shall we see if we can find it? Come, let's go and have a look. I don't know if we're going to. We might be lucky, we might not. A lion call, unlike our voices, you know that your voices can travel quite far. So if you are just thinking of where you sit at Rodin, if you are on the main field there, you can probably hear people calling or shouting at the swimming pool. You can hear them shouting. That's not too far away. But a lion's call would call, you'd be able to hear it calling all the way. I'll tell you how you know this. So if you were at St. John's, for example, across the road, all the way at the top in the college there, if there was a lion calling there, you'd be able to hear it in your classroom. That's how loud their voices are, which I think is really amazing. Now, good morning, Lucy. Very clever question from you. You say, did the lions finish eating their buffalo yesterday there on Cheetah Plains? Lucy, they did, and they went away. We don't know where they are now. And that's the thing about the wild out here. We wake up every morning, and every day is a new day, and things have moved on. So yes, they finished their buffalo, and the vultures are still there, I think. But the buffalo's gone, and so are the lions. We don't know where they are, but maybe one of the females is just up here. So we heard her calling down over there just before I saw you. So we're going to go up onto another road around that area and see if we can't see her. And what we'll do also, remember that you've got different senses in your body. You've got 5 different senses. You've got touch, that's what you can feel. You've got smell, that's what goes through your nose. You've got hearing, you've got your eyes, and you've got taste. Now in the wilderness out here, taste and touch, not quite so important if you're looking for animals, but if you're looking for animals, your eyes are obviously very important, but your ears are hugely important, because you can hear animals making different noises, and your sense of smell is also very good, because animals smell different. And although our noses aren't so very strong, like say the lions and the hyenas and various other animals, they're not too bad. And so you've got to use your nose and see if you can smell things. So for example, if you're walking through the bush and you smell something that smells like a dairy, you know what a dairy is, don't you? Where we get our milk from. Well, if you smell something that smells like a dairy, you know that there must be a buffalo around. So you've got to be very careful. You've got to listen, see if you can hear him grazing, or look carefully to see if you can see his horns. Thank you for your question, Krithika. Well done. Good one. You say, are there any crocodiles here in the park? Krithika, there are no crocodiles here because there's no river. But there are crocodiles a little bit further south. And I know that your dad and I have been to Londolozi before, and there you will find crocodiles because there's a river flowing through the middle of the reserve. No crocodiles here, but you know what? You must be very careful. Anytime you are in Africa or in a wild place like this, and anytime there is water anywhere, you don't know if there's a crocodile there, because crocodiles hide underneath the surface of the water. And so you have to be very, very careful about where you swim. Because if you can't see all the way to the bottom of the water, you mustn't get into it. Because crocodiles can hide everywhere. Now, I thought I heard this lion calling from somewhere just to the west of this road. That's to the left-hand side, so where I'm pointing now. We're going to go up a little bit further. We're going to watch the road and see if we can see any footprints. And we're also going to stop the car and just listen again and see if she calls. Which animal, Mantadi, you want to know makes the biggest poop? Well, have you ever seen poop the size of a soccer ball? An elephant makes poop the size of a soccer ball. That's the biggest that there is. My friend Byron has got something very special and very small to show you.
That's right, James. It is very special and is very small. Look at these dwarf mongoose, everybody. There's another one hiding just to the right behind that little stump on the termite mound. You can see them hiding there. They are so, so cute. They are always in big family groups. The little mongoose, the dwarf mongoose. It's the smallest mongoose we have. Look at that red nose. Very cute, very curious. Look how he's watching us. I hope James washes his hands before breakfast. I know he's been playing with some dung or poop over there. So these little dwarf mongoose live inside these termite mounds. And that's a nice big home for these dwarf mongoose. They do sleep underground, so they can use either these termite mounds or other little burrows or holes that they will have. Zaina has asked us a question about the hornbill we saw earlier. And she has asked, why do birds like to eat caterpillars? So Zaina, for some birds, and different birds feed on different things. Some birds like seeds and little grass seeds that they can find. Some like to feed on fruit. Some like to feed on insects. So those that like to feed on insects, if they find a nice big juicy caterpillar, it is a lovely bit of food for them. And a caterpillar is quite tasty for some birds. So they do like to feed on them, especially those hornbills. Like we saw earlier, these dwarf mongoose are enjoying the sun, trying to warm up. It's been quite a cold morning, so they're sitting right out in the sun, warming themselves up. So Pragnia has asked us a funny question. She has asked, where are all the animals at the moment? Are they still sleeping? So, Pragnia, they're probably not sleeping, but it has been a cold morning, so maybe they're still looking for a bit of shelter in amongst the trees, trying to stay out of the open, waiting for the sun to warm them up so that they'll start moving around. The animals, however, are always around. The thing is, we just occasionally struggle to find them. These are wild animals. You don't know where they are going to be or what they are going to do. We try our best to find them, but sometimes they do hide away from us. But I'm sure we'll get something else popping out a little bit later. But luckily, we've seen these beautiful dwarf mongoose. Oh, they are so cute, aren't they? Naila has asked us a question about a dwarf mongoose and how much it weighs. Naila, I'm going to double check in my book quickly exactly how much it weighs. I am not sure. I don't think it's very much at all. Let's see. The dwarf mongoose, let's see if they've got about 220 grams or 350 grams. Now I'm trying to think. Vim, what do you think weighs about the same as that? A can of Coke? What's a can of Coke? 200?
No idea.
220?
It's 350 mils.
350 mils doesn't weigh grams. No. We, right. You've stumped us.
Two packets of Simba chips.
Two packets of Simba chips. There we go. So, similar to the size of maybe a big hamster. A hamster. But yeah, a few packets of Simba chips. That's how much a dwarf mongoose weighs. But if I can show you quickly how big it is, just to give you a bit of perspective, if I was holding a little dwarf mongoose, it would only be about this big. Not very big at all, very, very small. So that's how big they would be. With the tail, they're maybe a little bit longer, about that long with the tail. But the body is only about that big, very, very small. So they're not very heavy at all. I'd think they'd probably make cute pets, but the problem is, if you get one, you'd have to have a whole family because they are always in family groups. And you can have 15 to 20, sometimes more, in a family group. So Madison just asked a question that I think I answered for you, Madison. They do live together, these mongoose. So they will live in a family of about, with the dwarf mongoose, maybe 15 to 20, sometimes more, sometimes less. We have another species of mongoose, a little bit bigger than these, called the banded mongoose. And they are also in big family groups, maybe 30 or 40. With the other species of mongoose, we do also get mongoose species around here that live alone. And those are the slender mongoose and the yellow-tailed mongoose, or the yellow mongoose. And what else do we get here? White-tailed mongoose, which is the biggest mongoose. They're also usually by themselves or maybe in pairs with one other one. But these ones are always in big groups, the dwarf mongoose. Lovely to see them out in the open. They are being very, very kind to us this morning. So Sasha's asked us, what do these little mongoose eat? So Sasha, these mongoose will feed on insects, mainly insects, but they also feed on little reptiles, maybe little lizards or little snakes if they can find them. Not really big snakes, they're a bit small for that, but mainly insects. They mainly feed on insects. We used to tease James a lot a few years ago. We would often say to James, when he would ask us, what do these animals eat? We would say, no, they eat fruit, nuts, and mice. It doesn't matter what it was that he asked us. And we used to tell him, no, they eat fruit, nuts, and mice. He used to get so cross with us. So he would say, what does an elephant eat? So we'd say, fruit, nuts, and sometimes mice. And he would get very upset with us. We know that that's not true. The elephant eat vegetation and grass, trees, and bark. But that question made me laugh and made me think of James asking a question about what animals eat. So if James had asked me that, I would tell him, fruit, nuts, and mice. But the dwarf mongoose only eat insects and other little reptiles, but mainly insects. They love feeding on insects. So Zippo has asked us, are there any meerkats in the park? Now, the meerkat does fall under the mongoose family, but Zippo, no, we don't have meerkats here. They are found in drier areas, drier parts of South Africa, and up into certain parts of Botswana and Namibia. They like almost desert-like conditions, So very dry areas. Not here, not in the Kruger National Park where we are. Let's get back to my friend James and see what he has got. Hopefully he's not playing with more dung.
I'm not playing with any more dung, everyone, but I've come into this area because we did find the lion tracks. You know, we heard them or saw them on the ground. Somewhere around here, this lioness made that call that she made just before I saw you. We've had no luck. So let's just quickly look over here. And we'll just be very careful. There could be a lioness lying anywhere under any of these bushes. But let's just look over here. This, of course, is mud, but only when it's very wet, when the rain comes. And what do you think made something this big? What kind of animal do you think came and made this amazing, what we call a pan? It's called a pan. Well, you can see, watch where I put my foot now. Can you see my foot, Dave?
Yes.
Look where I put my foot. Now, I don't have a very big foot. It's bigger than your feet, but it's not very big. But that it was made that big hole there was probably an elephant with an enormous foot. So you can see all around here the buffalo and the elephants and the rhino, they like to come and lie in this area when it's very hot in the summertime. Now let's just have a quick look inside here. And this mud is the best kind of mud. You know what mud's like. Mud is the best in the when it's wet. And you can play in it and you can spread it on your face and it feels quite nice. Anyway, that's what mud looks like when it's very dry. See? And the animals put that all over their skins in the same way that your mother puts cream on your skin and probably on her own skin. And they do the same with the mud to help them with their skin, and it keeps them safe from the sun sometimes, especially if you're a hippo or a rhino or something like that, then this mud protects the skin from the sun. Now, I can't hear anything else about this lion, so we're going to go around the way and see if we can't find her. Maybe she's gone onto another road close by here. Now, remember when you're out here, it's not always that dangerous to walk around. You just have to be a little bit careful. You have to be very careful and then look around the place. Ooh, sounds like Herbert has found something. I'm just quickly going to ask Herbert for an update. No, never mind. Okay. Sorry, can we have that question again, Louise? Go ahead, Herbert. Sorry, everyone. Ah. Okay, copy. I'm close by. I'll make my way there. We've got a very special chance, everybody, to see two little baby leopard cubs. So we're going to head that way. Oh, well, Byron's there. Great stuff. So Byron's going to go to those leopard cubs. So with any luck, we'll have this soon. Byron, you go ahead. No problem at all. So, it was a question about why it is that lions are so lazy. Well, all cats are pretty lazy. I know that some of you have got cats at home, and you know that those cats do almost nothing all day long. They just lie about the place. Well, one of the big reasons is that they only eat meat, lions. And you know, meat is tasty. It's very good if you're trying to build lots of muscles, but it's not so good if you are very, if you want to move around a lot. So you know that if you want to move around a lot, you've got to eat a lot of fat, and you've got to eat maybe some fruit, and that helps you if you're going to do your cross-country running. If you're going to swim in a gala or something like that, then that's the sort of thing you eat. But if you eat only meat, like a lion eats only meat, then it's very difficult to move around a lot. And that's why lions are lazy. But they are very lazy. I know some people who are that lazy too, you know. Now we're just going to look again for these lionesses while Byron, who's hopefully quite close by, gets to those leopard cubs. And it will be very, very special if we're able to see them. that will make our day. All right, let's head back to Byron. I think he's moving into that area where the leopards are.
Right, we have heard that the two little cubs, leopard cubs, are around here. Let's have a look, everybody. We need to drive very slowly. I hope the mother is with them too. Let's have a look. All right, let's have a look here. Oh, there we go, there they are. Can you see them? They're just on the ground. Look at that. Fantastic. Look at the little cubs, everybody. They are warming up in the sun too. Not sure where the mom is. She's maybe lying down at the bottom. But these two little ones, oh, this is great. And they seem very relaxed with us around them. Don't want to go too close. Don't want to disturb them. But they are very happy lying out in the open, in the sun, warming up. Aren't they beautiful? This is a little male and a female cub. Little boy and a girl. And they are about 4 months, almost 5 months old. So getting quite big, already eating a lot of meat that their mother is able to catch for them. So if she goes off and hunts and makes a kill, she will come back, call the cubs and take them to whatever it is that she has killed so that they can eat. She has been a very successful mother. She has been able to look after them and get them to this age. When they are very young, they are vulnerable to other predators. It's not always easy for leopard cubs or even lion cubs for that matter. So for a female leopard to look after the cubs and get them to this age, she has done very, very well. Look at those beautiful eyes. I hope all you young girls at Rodin are enjoying this. This is very, very special. They look almost like they're very lazy. They're just lying out resting. No need for them to move off anywhere. That one's playing with some grass on the branches in front of its face. We are so lucky to be able to see these little cubs. Not often you get to see leopard cubs, or even leopard for that matter. They're very, very shy, and they can hide away very, very well. So Michelle has asked us, where do the baby cubs sleep? So Michelle, at this age, the little cubs will sleep anywhere, maybe on the termite mound or up in a tree. They can rest up there or on the ground where they are at the moment. They'll sleep anywhere. When they are very young, and just after the female has given birth to them, they will sleep maybe in a little den site that the female has picked out for them. That could be anything. A dense thicket of bushes and trees that's very difficult to get into, or maybe in some rocks that she can hide the cubs. So any little den site where she can hide the cubs and keep them safe, she will hide them there for the first month to a month and a half, and then she might move them around to different areas, and the older they get, the more she will move them around. And now they don't have a den site, not at this age. She will move them wherever she goes and then leave them for a short while. If she goes to hunt, she will come back and call them, take them to the food once she has got something. But in the meantime, they can rest anywhere they like. And already at this age, they can climb trees very, very well. So they can climb up that tree right next to them, for example, and possibly sleep up there. This is so, so special, everybody. Trying to chase some flies. So, little Maddie has asked us, how long do leopards live for? So, Maddie, they will live for about 15 years to 17 years old. So not very long compared to us and how long people live. But for a leopard, that is a good lifespan. So about 15 years to 17 years old. Sasha has asked me where the mommy leopard is. I'm not too sure, Sasha. I haven't seen her. We are right on the edge of a little embankment or a little drainage line, and she may be down at the bottom somewhere, and we just can't see her. I don't want to drive around too much because I don't want to disturb the little cubs. They are very relaxed at the moment, and we have to be very sensitive around them. When they are young, we want to make sure that they become used to the vehicle and not scared of the vehicle. So I'm not going to drive around too much to look for the mom. If we're lucky, she may pop out while we are sitting here. She may be around, but I haven't seen her yet. So Morgan has asked us, can the baby cubs see when they're born? No, Morgan, they can't. They are blind. They are very, very helpless. They're completely blind. Just like, I don't know if any of you have ever had a dog have puppies. And you see the little puppies, their eyes are closed. They're blind. They can't walk. They can't see. Same with these little leopard cubs. Very, very helpless. And the female has to be very careful and look after them for the first few weeks until their eyes open and they're able to move around a little bit more. But like I said, she will hide them in a den so no one or nothing can get to them. And they are very safe in there, and she will look after them until they're able to move. That little one yawning. And look how well camouflaged they are. You can hardly see that leopard through there if it wasn't moving so much. So Chrisica has asked, how much do these cubs weigh? Chrisica, when they're born, they are around 500 grams. So not very heavy at all. If we think about it, double the size of those dwarf mongoose that we saw earlier. But these cubs at this age now, I would guess, are a few kilograms. They are definitely much heavier than that. So I would guess maybe around 4 to 5 kilograms, somewhere around there, perhaps. And then when they get older, they will start weighing a lot more. So the female leopards, when they are grown up, will weigh around 30 to 40 kilograms. And the male leopards, when they are big, they weigh much more than that. They will weigh around 70 or 80 kilograms, which I think is about the same as what James weighs. So very, very big. I just asked, if the mother leopard or the mommy leopard goes and makes a kill, does she take the cubs to the kill, or does she bring the food to the cubs? So she will take the cubs and she will take to the kill. It's easier for her to fetch the two little cubs that can walk and follow her, as opposed to her fetching the kill and trying to drag it all the way to where they are. So she will take them to the kill to eat. Asked, where is the daddy leopard? So Tony, the daddy leopard, or the male leopard, does not stay around the female when she has cubs. Only the female looks after the little cubs. The males do not. So he will be moving off in another area with looking after his territory, but he does not look after the little babies at all. How fantastic is this, everybody? So, so great. I'm so happy. So Lungelo has just asked us, how old are the leopard cubs when they start hunting for themselves? So Lungelo, when the leopard cubs get to about a year and a half on average, and that is when these little cubs, or by that stage they will be quite big, that is when they will leave the mom. The mom will then push them off and they have to go and look after themselves. So from that age they will have to hunt for themselves, but they start learning from about a year old. They may try and hunt little birds like Franklin, or a little mongoose. So from at least a year old, maybe even a bit earlier, they will start learning, but they will have to hunt properly for themselves from about 1.5 years old. Then they need to hunt to look after themselves. There is a squirrel in the tree above the leopard cubs, and he is making a lot of noise. He's not happy about those little leopard cubs lying underneath his tree. You can't really see him now. He's just hiding behind some branches, but I can hear him. So while these cubs are still lying down and you see they've gone to rest, James has got much bigger animals with him at the moment. Go have a look.
Oh, we're so lucky today, everybody. Look at the elephants. Lots and lots of them. Please try and count them for me and tell me how many you can see. I'm going to count them on my own. And you count them as they go away from having their morning drink. They're going to go off into the bush and they're going to eat lots of leaves and bark like I showed you. And they're also going to drop lots of dung. And it's very important, that dung, for plants. It helps them to grow. Just like when your mother perhaps fertilizes the lawn or perhaps fertilizes her roses. I know my mum used to, around about this time of the year, put some disgusting smelling stuff on her roses in Johannesburg. All right, let's try and count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 58, 59, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 57, 58, moving around. Now, if you want to count them, the best thing to do is to watch them all walk past one place. Otherwise, it becomes very difficult to see. Andrew, try and get hold of Byron. He'll help you in there. Isn't that lovely? Louise, please tell Byron to get hold of Andrew on the radio. All right, ladies at Rodin, especially Madam Creel and Madam McConnell, and of course, special Krithika. I hope you guys have a wonderful day there at school. We're going to sit here with the elephants. My day is really looking really good. This is what I do for a living. Isn't that wonderful to sit here with wonderful elephants and little leopard cubs for a living? Go and enjoy your mathematics and your English and your science and do well, and we'll hopefully see you again soon. Bye-bye. All right, everybody, let's just a little sigh of relief out that David and I have managed to find something. Byron is just helping Andrew into that cub sighting, and seems like it's all rather stable there, which is nice, but I think it's interesting that Karula's clearly been away all night, and I suspected she might be. Hello, Carolyn. It sounds like you're a new viewer, and that's wonderful. Thank you for giving us your time to watch us, and mostly, of course, thanks for sending us a question. You say, do both male and female elephants have tusks, and what are they used for? Carolyn, African elephants, both male and female, have tusks, absolutely. Indian elephants or Asian elephants do not. So in the Asian elephant, only the male has got tusks. That tells you quite a lot about what they're used for. So tusks out here are used extensively for feeding. They're used to peel the bark off of trees. They're used to help snap pieces of grass and twigs from the bushes on which the elephants are feeding, and they are to a certain extent used for defense, and they can be, I mean, certainly if an elephant attacks something, that's what it's going to use. It's going to use its tusks to cause injury. Look at this magnificent herd of elephants. I think there must be 40 or 50 of them there. Isn't that brilliant? And Carolyn, the thing with elephant tusks, of course, is that they are so very variable. So you can see that herd is almost exclusively females and their youngsters. And they've all got tusks and they're all different shapes and sizes. Now, I don't think an Asian elephant has got tusks, mainly because it's an area that has probably had fewer predators for elephants. And also, they live largely in a forest area where the nutrients are greater than they are out here, and so they can just bite things off trees and use their trunks. They don't have the same need as our African elephants to sort of dig up roots and peel off bark and do all that sort of thing. There, Dave, on the top of the bank now, an enormous elephant bull. He's only got one tusk, Carolyn, and he's obviously broken it off, the other one, and that will have hurt horridly. You see him there, Dave? There we are. Fantastic stuff. All right, Red, you say yesterday you saw an elephant without tusks. We did, we saw a big bull without tusks. Red, it's genetic. It's just some of them have tusks and some of them simply do not. While this fellow comes down to drink, let's go and find out what's going on with those little cubbies.
So we're still sitting here. The little cubs haven't moved. Still just at the bottom of the tree. Great to see them. Not sure, I think the little girls of Rodin have left us for the morning. So Martin has asked us a question. Does a male leopard recognize his offspring? Yes, Martin, they do. Just like lions do, they will most likely recognize the scent, and especially whether or not they've mated with that female. But I have seen male leopards recognize their offspring and their young. But females do still try and keep the cubs away from males, just purely because they get a little bit nervous and they... You know, a lot of the bigger cats can become a bit unpredictable, and especially if there's a kill around, they may become aggressive. So they've got to be careful with the little cubs. But they do recognize them, and I have seen cubs, even at an older age of a year and a half, interact with the father. And the only reason we definitely know it was the father is because we were able to see everything take place from the mating to the 90 days later, or it's generally 90 to 100 day gestation period for females, and we were then able to view the cubs, so we knew exactly which females or which female mated with which male, and got to see the interaction with the cubs and the father. So I have seen that happen before. Go ahead. Yeah, I'll copy that, James. They're quite relaxed at the moment. I'm going to keep it to one vehicle. And there's no reason to off-road and disturb them. You can view them from the road. There are two vehicles on standby at the moment. I'm going to make space shortly for Andrew, who's going to move in, and Barbara on standby one after that. So Eritus has asked, can we tell male and female leopards apart by head shape or perhaps pattern, just like we can with the elephant? So Eretus, at this age, no, it's very, very difficult. When they get older, though, you might be able to, and I think the more experience you have in seeing male and female leopards, it does become a bit easier. So what you can look for is the size, just overall size. The male has got a much rounder head and often gets a big dewlap forming under the throat, whereas the females have a smaller, slightly more slender head as opposed to a male. So yes, you can tell the difference by size the older they get when they are adults, but at this age you wouldn't be able to, not by just looking at them. You'd have to look very carefully and look for male or female genitalia. So Greg and Nevin have asked, how far will a mother leopard venture away from the cubs when she's hunting? It all depends when she finds food. She can move a few kilometers if she has to. She would try her best to hunt something within the area or close by. But I have seen leopards go and hunt a kilometer, at least almost 2 kilometers away from where the cubs are, and then go back and fetch them and take them to a kill if she isn't successful in the area. But she may try, like I said, it's difficult. It's when she finds food and she's able to hunt, but she will venture quite a distance if she has to. So, you know, like I say, it can be up to about 1 kilometer at times. If it's closer, it's beneficial for her and much better. Really special. These cubs are so comfortable and so relaxed. Just see that little belly as it's breathing in and out. And look at those beautiful rosettes already on this cub. When they're very young, those patterns aren't quite clear yet. They seem a little fuzzy, a little blurry. And then the older they get, those rosettes become very prominent and very clear. That squirrel has not stopped. Copy, Andrew. Make your way straight in. I'll just stand by in this area just to point out exactly where they are for you. We're going to try and get some other people into this area to have a look at these leopard cubs. We've been very fortunate to see them, but it is very, very special and very lucky. So we would like some of the other guests in the area to also see them while they're out on the safari. And because they are still very young, we have to be a bit sensitive. We don't want to have too many vehicles around them. As I said, we don't want to scare them or push them away. And at the moment, this is perfect. They're very relaxed, they're very calm, and don't feel threatened. They're still out in the open. And that is what we want. And then in the future, when they get older, we'll be able to have wonderful sightings of them to come. I think we're going to move away from them shortly, see what else we can find. What I think we should do is cross over to James. I think he had some impala that may have run away already. But go to James and we'll see you a little bit later.
Well, we did have a herd of impala here, naturally, of course. They As they heard you were going to come and see them, they absconded into the bushes, which is unfortunately what tends to happen. I had a magnificent sighting of one young male here who looked at me, and I thought about taking my camera out, and then he ran away. Beastly little fellow that he is. Anyway, very glad we've got those cubbies there. I think it's fascinating that Karula's decided that she's spending more and more time away from them. Don't know where she is. I didn't see any tracks of her. Herbert obviously had some tracks and then lost them, but at least we have the little ones there, and that's great. Now, we are on Arethusa, and we're heading down what is known as Parallel Road. This is round about where I had hoped to spot Shadow the other day, but I gave up on that eventually after she thoroughly beat me. Now, I just saw a track that looked not entirely unlike a wild dog track, but it was on a piece of gravel, so difficult to tell. I've had no other updates from this area today, so we'll just see what we can find as we crawl gently towards the south. I always feel slightly different on Arethusa, but I suppose that's entirely psychological, given that the landscape is entirely the same. That big herd of elephants is heading south, looks like maybe towards the Juma Dam, so if you are watching the Juma Dam cam, please keep watching it. I think they're probably going to feed in the woodland there for a while, and then as the heat builds, they may well either go back to Sydney's dam for another drink, or maybe they'll head for a mud bath at the Juma Dam or the Galago Pan. So keep an eye out on the camera for the course of the day. I'm not convinced that David and I have found less than we've found today. Ah, now, Justin, what a great question from you. You've obviously been doing a bit of reading about this area. You say, why were wild dogs once considered pests? Well, the facetious answer is because human beings are so profoundly stupid. The less judgmental answer, which is the one I shall give you, is that they were considered to be vicious killers and wanton killers that created unnecessary pain for the animals that they killed, and therefore they didn't have the right to live. There were lots of them as well. And they also, when people brought domestic stock into this area, they took out quite a lot of domestic stock. Now, we know for certain that, or almost for certain, that wild dogs are no more vicious at killing than any other animal out here. And in fact, death obviously often ensues for their prey faster than it does for lion's prey, for example. So that is just simply not true. And even if it were true, it comes from that kind of 19th century attitude of the wild, where we thought we had the sort of moral high ground on which to judge how things should and shouldn't happen out here. It wasn't only wild dogs that were shot as vermin. Lions and leopards were often shot as vermin. And we're mercifully past those days, but it is one of the reasons that wild dogs are so endangered. Hello, Elizabeth in Santa Monica. Very nice to hear from you today. You say, are there any invasive species in the park, and, you know, how they affected the ecology? There are no invasive mammals, no. There are no exotic mammals at all. The exotic species that there are things like, are much smaller. They'd be difficult things to get rid of. Stuff like, I'm sorry, my earpiece is really being irritating in my ear. So we've got, there's a snail, there's something called a banded snail that Steph discovered here the other day. We know that's invasive. Probably kills or outcompetes local snails. We know